I'm now at Fontainebleau Chateau in the town of Fontainebleau. This is one of those travel days that was perfect. Timing was perfect. Left the hotel, got on one metro, immediately came down the stairs, jumped on the next metro, got to the train station, had 6 minutes, walked right to the train, got on, got off the train with a fellow Frenchman who was helping me at that point, got immediately on the bus and came right out here to Fontainebleau. I was here 15 minutes early so that I could get some tea and a couple croissants across the street, and now I'm entering it. Doesn't look like there's many people here. The tour buses will be here shortly, I'm sure, but this is a great time to be here. This apparently was the Versailles before Versailles, but I'll voice over a lot of this. A little bit closer view. The elegant stairway, and probably the kings would stand at the top in the center, wait for the appropriate nobles to show their obeisance by hiking up the stairs. Here we'll take a little bit closer look at the stairway. And it's kind of unfortunate that they don't bother to restore at least half the stairway. It would look even more elegant and imposing. Perhaps these were porticos that the guards hung out in. So to make it as realistic as possible, I, as king, would have exited this door, these doors here. Of course, I would not have opened them myself. And then from this spot, I would have deigned to allow you riffraff to approach on the stairways under protection of my guards, of course. But think of the careers that hung in the balance in just that scenario. Interesting to look at some of the detail on the banisters. It's the standard. Looks like two snakes entwined around a sepulchre with wings on it. One wonders if these end pieces were not statues of something at one time. We're now filming Fontainebleau. The earlier part of this tape with the exterior is on the prior tape. On the way up the stairway, it would have been one of the stairways used here. And probably another long corridor, somewhat like the one that we saw before. I don't know if this was original or not. This was the entrance to the grand apartments and the apartment of Napoleon I. The little corporal lived well, didn't he? This is called a stucco effect. Why, I don't know. But it's because it gives the impression of the material being marble, which apparently it is not. The last person to live in here was Napoleon III. This room was built by Napoleon III to provide a proper entry for guests to the royal apartments. There you can see the end for Napoleon. And this is coat of arms. This painting reflects how it was at the time of Louis XIV. This was his hunting lodge. But there we see a better view of the gardens, of the canal in the middle there, of the fountains. I don't know how much of that exists today. And the city of Fontainebleau behind. These buildings up front are original and are still here. Two long buildings on either side of that square would have been built later on. This depicts a fire at Fontainebleau which destroyed the theater. These are the three paintings on this elaborate chest. This shows the arrival of the soon-to-be queen and her reception at the top of the stairs by the king. And here the Catholic wedding. This room filled with all of these plates, each of which has a story or a picture on it. There are 128 of these china dishes depicting scenes from Fontainebleau as well as scenes from the king's during the king's exile. I can't remember the name of the king. Might be some other Philippe. And here an interesting one seems to suggest that where I asked the question, was there ever anything on these cement end pieces? Apparently there were. They were much larger, and there was a large colossus statue. The scene of the time when it had a moat and canals. These were never meant to be used, they were meant only to be decorated. Here, for example, is Niagara Falls, which the king apparently visited during his exile. These oil lamps are converted, but they're the original ones of Louis Philippe. This room is the vestibule off of the top of the stairway. The entrance to that top of the stairway is to my far right. I'm going to look at these doors a little more closely. Beautifully carved. But you have to remember, this was the seat of the King of France for several kingdoms, not to mention our boy Napoleon. The inscription over this door, which goes to the chapel, says, "Fear God, honor royalty." A subtle way of saying, if you don't honor royalty, you'll know damn well why you should fear God, because in the name of God, we'll toast your wagon. Look at the massive carving on this. This furniture is original. It's the chair of the usher. Wouldn't you love to find that at a garage sale? And his table where he would accept and then introduce people who visited here. The clock was an 18th century clock installed by Napoleon III. This is Trinity Chapel. Probably one of the most extraordinary and flamboyant, grandiose churches or church-like things that I've been in. Maybe even ever. The paintings on the wall and the ceilings, I'm sure, are of legend. Just imagine the wealth of France that went into this. Notice these massive doors and what spectacular carving on those. The helmet, apparently, of whoever this is. Notice that their hair is made of snakes. And a quiver of arrows. Something in there looks like the depiction of horns, but I don't know. Don't know who the bearded man is, but it's a lion's head on top of his head. This is the gallery of Francois the First. Remember that Francois the First was the man who lived in the chateau in Amboise and provided Leonardo da Vinci with his home at Le Clos Lucie, where he lived for 3 years before he died. This room was built by Francois the First simply as a conduit from the rooms to the left to his private rooms that are behind the camera. But eventually he began to develop it and to have it done by an Italian artist who was followed the Michelangelo philosophies, whatever those are, and had this mix of walnut with gold overlay, and then the statues, and then the frescoes. The frescoes apparently depict, in the Italian style, events of Francois the First's reign, which makes me wonder, where's the subtitle for this one? At any rate, he prized this room so much that he kept the key for himself and made it a private room and would show it to those he chose to, including Charles the First of somewhere, who he wanted to impress. It became known throughout France and Europe as the first, I think they called it the Italian Renaissance design, and it was known at that time. He thinks this is a battle, and the man below that boat is about to get clubbed with an oar. But what did one man do in a room like this? I guess this is the venue of the wealthy. When you have something so much, so big. Battle against the centaurs. Interesting propriety. Or lack of. My guess is this is the man himself. Interesting, there we see the Francois F. Don't know what the two little urchins there, they're probably angels. I think those are wings on the back. What's curious is this. His symbol was the salamander. This doesn't look at all like a salamander. It looks like some kind of evil beast. View of some of the lakes. I wonder what that little building was used for. Trysts. This was the first room in the king's apartments, but all that remains are the ceiling and the frieze around the top. Presumably, this magnificent fireplace did not exist at the time. This fireplace was composed of elements that were in other fireplaces in the chateau that were recovered during the constant building and rebuilding process. This is a remarkable vase. Certainly the devil's there on the left side and right with the horns. This room was used by the guards as the protection to the king before entrance into his actual apartment. These are apparently the apartments that were approaching of the woman of the house at that time, each time, I suppose. Don't know how much we can see of this elegant room with the reflection. Somebody's cute little bed. Notice how the curtains didn't cover the entire bed. A little fireplace. This is apparently the ballroom. One can only imagine the look of this when it's filled with the people. The intrigue that goes on here. How people sat on benches like those, having intimate little conversations, knowing where it was best to sit, where their mate would not be able to detect the conversation, etc., etc., etc. How many feet tripped the light fantastic on this parquet floor? And stood by those windows and gazed out that glass at those gardens. And look at that. When the ballroom was first designed, it was designed to have a huge vaulted ceiling. But that did not occur, and in fact there's this coffered ceiling, I guess it's called. And this one quite renowned among people who know about coffered ceilings. This is the original oval courtyard. So
Certainly it was an intimidating imagery to see this colossal wealth. It certainly was a reflection, at least of foreign dignitaries, I'm sure, of the wealth and power that France presumed itself to have. This sculpture was created by Francois I, or I mean he had it commissioned. Go figure out what it means. In order to support a bowl. As you can see, there's her head and hands at the top to support some bowl. These were the royal bedchambers up until the 16th century. And one of the indications that the audio guide gives of the fact that this was a fort in the past was the thickness of the walls you can see here, and even more so the thickness of that arch, which in fact breached a fortress wall as this was in the process of development. These are the king's state apartments. In other words, they were formal apartments. A series of rooms linked together, then the queen's linked together, then more of the king's. These were used for very specific functions, and only a few people were privy to them. Not everyone in the court was allowed in these rooms. The statue depicting the prize of the hunt, the dead fox. In one of these staterooms, Louis XIII was born in a small tent that was set up in the middle of the room, because by French law, it was necessary that the birth of a king, an heir to the throne, had to be in public. This was the dining room of Napoleon I. This was originally the queen's bedchamber. Be the library. There's the huge globe. I wonder if that was original. This room, which is now a library, obviously, was originally a salon of the queen. And it was designed for her to take an inside stroll. Bet you the people of France would have loved knowing they worked their ass off for this one. 3 years before the French Revolution, Marie Antoinette had this room redesigned. Elegant doors entering, the locks, double locked, triple locked. This was Napoleon's official throne room. This was Napoleon I's actual bed and bedroom. And little steps that he could use to climb into bed. Think of the thoughts the man thought in that bed. Think of the other things he got away with doing. This was actually Napoleon's study, but the camp bed, so they call that, doesn't look like any camp bed I ever saw, was installed here in 1811, so he could always take a quick snooze there if he needed to. I put a bed in my living room, that might work well. This red room is famous more for its history than anything else. It's believed that on this table, Napoleon signed his abdication on April 6, 1814, before making a farewell to his troops. This is the chapel scene from the first floor. A bright, elegant, rich, don't know how words to use to describe how, I guess, majestic this is. Somewhat dark and somber and I don't know what you'd call a Greek or Roman look of this. There's an interesting counterpoint to the chapel, which is bright and opulent, whereas this relies on shadows, simple arches. This looks like one tired Mary, given all the work the Catholic Church gave to her. May well be the case. I wonder if he remembered the people that he was in the military with when he first started as a corporal. I wonder if they had access to him when he was king. This is the palace. Notice the horseshoe-shaped staircase. Small part of the garden area. I'm gonna walk down to where the water is. Imagine building a business building of this size so you'd have a place for more of your friends to come and visit. Looks like this statue at one time would have had a shield on his left arm and a sword of some sort in his right hand. I wonder if Napoleon ever used this area. Might have gone down those steps for a little dip in the water. Maybe reenacted the sea battles if he had any. Maybe sat on a bench like I'm sitting on with Josephine. Talked about how she couldn't give him a child and so he was gonna dump her. She got all teary-eyed and said, "I'll take you for half everything you're worth." These white ducks are interesting. I saw one hanging out two different days, same place, with a mallard male.
See, this is what's supposed to be in these little niches. A statue of some sort. I don't know if I've seen any other examples of them. This, I think, is an original carousel. And it certainly looks like they're made out of wood and original. Yeah, you can see the seams there. Oh, that's interesting. Well, a two-tiered one. I'll be darned. I don't know that I've ever seen one. I'll just do something new. This is the post office in Fontainebleau, which is a stately building. Looks like it would have been 18th century. I mean, right, 19th century, probably 18th. Somewhere 1850 and on. I always get confused by that. But it's posts and telegraphs, so it would have been after the telegraph had been developed, but probably before the phone. Pretty little town with pretty buildings way down there. Looks like a vibrant small town. I don't know what that building is, but it's a good looking building. This church was built in 1868.